Hello friends, this interview is saying today we are going to discuss a very important topic, establishment of British Empire in India. Before going into the chapter, I would like to introduce with the political conditions of India during 18th century. Before the 18th century, Mughals were succeeded in establishing unity in almost all part of India. But after the death of Aurangzeb in 1707, decline of Mughal Empire started. Due to the orthodox policies introduced by Aurangzeb, the revolts of the Marathas, Sikhs and the Jats. Also, after his death, there was no emperor in Mughal dynasty who could check this revolt and reunite the Mughal Empire. Mansabdars and governors appointed by the Mughals in various parts of the country to administer these regions grew powerful. And when they saw that there is no efficient ruler in the center, then they declared themselves independent, as happened in the case of Bengal, Awadh and Hyderabad. Also, Mughals were started by the various Afghan invaders such as Nadir Shah and Ahmad Shah Abdali. And now during the 18th century, European powers such as Dutch, French, Portuguese and English began to establish their companies in India and start meddling with the Indian affairs. So all these factors made the control of Mughals over India very very weak and inefficient. As the later Mughals were very weak, so rise of various states took place in various parts of the country, such as Marathas. The empire became prominent under the leadership of Chhatrapati Shivaji in 17th century. It attained its peak under the guardianship of Peshwas. It extended from present-day Pakistan in west to Orissa in east, and from Punjab in north to central Karnataka in south. Marathas were able to establish a protectorate over the Mughal emperor and a paramount easy of numerous Rajput chieftains of Gujarat, Rajasthan, central India and elsewhere. But this vast empire declined gradually after the third battle of Panipat, fought between Marathas and Nadir Shah's general Ahmad Shah Abdali in 1761. Many trading companies were formed in Europe to trade with India and other parts of Asia and Africa. One of the first trading companies to trade with India was Portuguese. They discovered the sea route to India under Vasco da Gama in 1498. They controlled the trade along the Malabar coast and established their headquarters in Kochi and other trade settlements in Daman and Diu. Their position was consolidated by able generals like Almeida and Albuquerque. The second trading company to come to India was Dutch. After seeing successful trade of Portuguese, they started their 5 expeditions to trade with East, but few of them were successful. And as they were purchasing spices from the Portuguese to sell in the Europe, they established Dutch East India Company in 1602. As they were interested in spices, so they pushed their rival Portuguese off the Malayan coast and Indonesian island. They established their first headquarters at Puligat and later Nagapattinam. In 1658, they won Ceylon from Portuguese and also established their trading centers at Ahmedabad, Bharuch, Surat, Kochi, Masulipatnam. But in 1759, they lost at the hands of British at the Battle of Bedara and collapsed completely. The next trading company was French. It came to India around 1660s and they established their first factory at Surat. In 1674, they made Pondicherry as their headquarter. They had a very strong hold in South India and conquered islands such as Mauritius and Bourbon. In 1742, Duplessis was appointed as a French governor and he waged various wars against English and won many of them. He was a very able and efficient leader. But in 1774, he was called back. Now, in the absence of Dupleix, the French got defeated by the English East India Company at the Battle of Vandivos and collapsed completely. Now, the last and most important English. They became supreme naval power by defeating Spanish Armada in 1588. Now they established East India Company in 1600. Hawkins, the ambassador of King James I, got a farman from Jahangir, the then Mughal emperor, to open a factory at Surat in 1609. But the Portuguese were not happy with that, so the farman was taken aback by Mughal emperor. But the English defeated Portuguese at the Battle of Swally Hole in 1612, and then they were granted the rights to carry on the trade in India and other parts. Again in 1615, English ambassador Thomas Rowe got permission from Mughal emperor to open new factories at Agra, Ahmedabad and Baroch. As the conditions to open factories in south were more favorable, as there were no strong opposition, in 1639, East India Company established Madras on a piece of land granted to them by the Raja Chandragiri. They built Fort St. George along the factory. In 1650, the company got the permission to carry on the trade in Bengal also. And in 1661, they were granted the permission to issue coins, build forts, maintain army, and declare war and peace. Moreover, Bombay was handed over to company which Charles II got as a dowry from the Portuguese princess. And in 1698, company developed three villages, namely Govindpuri, Kalikata and Sutanadi, into a city known Calcutta nowadays. As we have discussed above also, that after the death of Aurangzeb, no efficient ruler came, and hence the governors of various states such as Bengal, Awadh and Hyderabad declared themselves independent. So, taking advantage of this political confusion, Ali Wardi Khan, the governor of Bengal, asserted his independence. And he was wise enough to keep the European merchants under his control. Siraj ud-Daula, his grandson, succeeded him in 1756 and objected the company that why they were building forts and maintaining army, as they were just a trading company. So he ordered them to immediately stop the fortification, but the orders of Siraj ud-Daula were denied by the British company. And as a result, Siraj ud-Daula attacked in Fort William and captured many of the Europeans in dungeons known as Black Hole, where many deaths occurred. Because of this, the company waged a war against Siraj ud-Daula under the leadership of Robert Clive. And this battle was known as Battle of Plassey. It was fought between Siraj ud-Daula and his French allies, and between East India Company. It was fought at the Plassey near Murshidabad, the then capital of Bengal, which is around 150 km away from Calcutta. The French sent a small army contingent to fight on the behalf of Siraj ud-Daula. But the main turning point of the war was that Mir Jafar, who was the general of Nawab, defected to British. As a result, Siraj ud-Daula lost. And this is the first battle in which a trading company defeated a Indian ruler. And now the entire province of Bengal fall into the hands of company. The enormous wealth gained from Bengal treasury allowed the company to significantly strengthen its military might. Now Mir Jafar was made Nawab of Bengal, and the company ruled on his behalf. Means he was just a face, and all the working was being done by the company. And when he came to know this, he rebelled the company, which led to the Battle of Buxar, fought between British East India Company and combined forces of Mir Qasim, the then Nawab of Bengal, Shah Alam II, the then Mughal Emperor, and Shuja ud-Daula, who was the governor of Awadh. The battle was fought at Buxar in Bihar, near the banks of Ganga River. Shuja ud-Daula was the Nawab of Awadh, not the governor. And as we have discussed that after the Battle of Plassey, the company had grown its military might. So again in this battle, British East India Company won. As a result of that, Shah Alam II and Shuja ud-Daula had to sign the Treaty of Allahabad, which gave Diwani rights to collect taxes from Bengal, Bihar and Orissa. Now, Nawab totally became dependent upon company and had to pay rupees 30 lakh at that time to retain his Nawabship. Conflict with Mysore. Mysore is situated in Karnataka and controlled trade route of Malabar coast. In 1785, Tipu Sultan, the then ruler of Mysore, stopped export of sandalwood, pepper and cardamom, and also disallowed the local merchants to deal with the company. he had established close relations with the French and thus modernized his army with their help. As Mysore was becoming a trouble for EIC, meaning East India Company, so they fought four Anglo-Mysore wars. First in 1767-69, second 1782-84, third 1790-92, and fourth and last one in 1799, which was known as Battle of Seringapatam. Seringapatam is the capital of Mysore, and in this battle, Tipu Sultan was killed. Now, Mysore was placed under the Wodeyar dynasty, and subsidiary lines was imposed over Mysore. Relations with Sikhs. The Sikhs were the finest soldier in India. They always supported Ranjit Singh to bring the whole of the Punjab under his control. Ranjit Singh was the chief of Sukra Chakia Mission. He was very bold and strong. He won the respect of the British and entered into the Treaty of Amritsar in 1809 between Maharaja Ranjit Singh and English, which states that Satluj River was considered as the boundary between the two. Now, other Mughals also accepted his supremacy and he became the Maharaja of Punjab. He extended his empire and included Peshawar, Multan, Kashmir, Kangra, Hazara, Ladakh and the fort of Jamrud in his territories. But he could not win since because of the opposition by the British. He was very brave and strong and thus called as the Lion of Punjab. He checked the British army by his strength and diplomacy. But after his death in 1839, rivalries became common to acquire the throne and relations with the British worsened. Two wars were fought in 1845-46 and 1848-49, which led to the annexation of the Punjab by the British. Administration under the British rule. The civil service. The civil service was founded by Lord Cornwallis. A nomination system was followed by the directors of the company. Under this, the members of the aristocracies were generally nominated by the company's director. It was followed till 1853. Then Indian civil services exam was started, but initially Indians were not allowed to appear according to the Act of 1793, which stated that no Indian is eligible for post carrying 500 pounds or more as a salary. But slowly, as the English realized that Indians were more honest and hard-working, so they began to train them at Fort William College in Calcutta and at Hullyburg in London named East India College. But then also, very few Indians could compete for these posts. Second to come is the army. Army also played a major role in protecting company from foreign invaders such as the Dutch, French or the Portuguese. It also conquered the territories of the native rulers. It crushed the rebels whenever they raised their heads in various parts of the country. In army also, there was great disparity among Indian and British soldiers. The highest post that was given to the Indians was of Subedar, having only 300 rupees salary per month. And also, Indian soldiers were debarred from getting higher posts. Now coming on to the police, in each district, superintendent of police was appointed as a chief, district police chief. And under each district, many thanas came, and each thana was headed by a daroga. The main aim of the police was to maintain law and order, but generally they took bribes and often harassed people. The fourth and the most important, judicial service. Courts were set up in India by Lord Hastings and they were divided into two. First was civil court and second was criminal court. Civil court was under the control of collectors of company and the criminal court was left to the Indians. Criminal court was further divided into two, Sadar Diwani Adalat and Sadar Nizamat Adalat. Under the Regulating Act of 1773, English judge tried to apply English laws into the country, but not appreciated by nor the Indians nor the company. Again, under Regulating Act of 1793, Cornwallis Code was compiled, which accommodated personal laws of Hindus and Muslims both. In 1833, Indian Law Commission was set up to codify Indian law procedure and laws. And now we know that British was able to control all of the country within a small period of 100 years, which was possible due to the methods of expansion of English territories in India. First to come is by conquest, by direct use of army against the Indian rulers. Second to come is the subsidiary lines. It was a policy introduced by Lord Wellesley. According to it, ruler entering into alliance would give some money or territory to maintain British contingent into the territory. Such rulers would not enter into any alliance or not declare war without permission of the English. They should not employ non-English, and if already employed, they should be dismissed immediately. And in return, company would protect state from internal as well external affairs. Nizam of Hyderabad was first to enter into the subsidiary lines. Then also, after the Battle of Seringapatnam, Mysore was also forced to enter into the subsidiary lines. And later, Maratha ruler Bajirao II was also forced to enter into the subsidiary lines in the Treaty of Vassi. Second policy that was used by the Britisher was Doctrine of Lapse. It was introduced by Lord Dalhousie. According to it, if Indian ruler did not have real son, then the adopted heir will not be allowed to rule, and eventually control of the state will fall into the hands of British. Using this doctrine of lapse, they annexed Satara, Nagpur, the famous one Jhansi, Udaipur and Jaipur. The fourth to come is alleged misgovernment. According to it, the British would allege that there was bad administration and the Indian ruler was not competent to rule properly. On this excuse, they would annex this kingdom as they did in the case of Awadh. So here, as you can see, the yellow ones are the British India states and the pink one the subsidiary line states.